Hello, 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 and welcome back to another Vampire the Masquerade lore video. Anyone who's played Bloodlines 1 has an immediate familiarity with the Camarilla. Upon embrace, the player character is dragged onto a stage before an impromptu vampire court, forced to watch their sire get beheaded, and is then forcibly made subservient to the whims of the prince, LaCroix. But what are the goals of the Camarilla? What is it they pursue night after night? Today we're going to talk about those vampires who reside and work their machinations inside the Ivory Tower. When the Camarilla was founded in the 15th century, the leaders elevated their most ruthlessly enforced tradition, the Masquerade, to their highest law and priority. Simplified, the Masquerade keeps kine, the humans, as unaware as possible of the existence of vampires as a preventative measure against an uprising that would likely lead to an extermination of the undead. Breaking the Masquerade, such as using disciplines of vampiric powers in a public setting, is usually met with swift and severe punishment by the Camarilla. When a Masquerade violation occurs, the prince of the city can call a blood hunt on the offending vampire, which ends, more often than not, in their final death.
A blood hunt is a death sentence. When one commits a high crime against our society, a blood hunt may be called. It is then the responsibility of the city's kindred to bring the offender final death.
Ultimately, the kindred of the Camarilla believe the Masquerade will keep a quiet harmony between vampires and humans, a goal that is constantly under threat by the Sabbat. This ongoing conflict has led to Camarilla elders becoming paranoid, desperately clinging to their territories, all while proclaiming the Camarilla's strength and unity.
Doddering old dust farts. They might be powerful as all hell, but who knows? They're too afraid to stick their heads out of their hidey holes, and why should they? This whole huge system is built so they don't have to.
Newly embraced vampires find themselves treated more like serfs to their sires and elders, with little hope of advancement but a high likelihood of punishment.
It's a sham, a pyramid scheme. Nothing but musty, withdrawn elders waging power struggles for no other reason than to keep their own ass alive for one more century. You think you have any real power in the cam? You're kidding yourself.
Perhaps the only thing neonates have going for them is their understanding of modern technology and social media, something that eludes the older vampires they serve. Well, at least it was an advantage. But according to Vampire the Masquerade version 5, the Camarilla has all but banned the use of it. There's a severe mistrust at play, and most princes have instituted an official ban within their territories. Despite all of this, the Camarilla considers themselves to be vampire society.
In this age of information, videotape, and weapons of mass destruction, the Camarilla is more necessary than it has ever been. The alternative to thorough secrecy these days is extinction. As long as we exist, so shall kindred society.
For hundreds of years, the Camarilla has denied the existence of antediluvians, the progenitors of the clans. They once believed that they were no more than myths, or at the very least, long dead. Many of the elders privately knew otherwise, but that was the party line.
As for it containing an ancient kindred, the Camarilla does not put stock in the actuality of antediluvians. They're myths. Don't let anyone tell you differently.
Because the Camarilla denies the existence of the Fathers. They deny that Cain was the original vampire. They deny all the legends. Fear and the end of the world are bad for business, you know?
This was further reinforced in Bloodlines 1 with how heretical LaCroix was being when he was speculating about a slumbering antediluvian in the Ankaran sarcophagus.
Its contents will maintain our rule for centuries to come. I felt it. All have felt it since it appeared. But until we get the key back, we're vulnerable.
In Modern Nights, version 5 of Vampire the Masquerade, the Camarilla now admits that antediluvians are probably real and engage in a sort of ancestor worship. That is to say, if the antediluvians exist and haven't put a stop to the Camarilla, then they're obviously on the Camarilla's side. The Camarilla are also the largest sect of kindred, comprised of a multitude of different clans and bloodlines. They hold arguably the most city territories, and in theory, any vampire may go to a city's prince and claim their membership with the sect. However, Camarilla cities are not as cosmopolitan as they proclaim. Yes, it's true that any vampire can become members, but the clans with the most power come from the Camarilla's founding clans. Bruja, Gangrel, Malkavian, Nosferatu, Toreador, Tremere, and Ventru. Vampires of other bloodlines are treated as minority voices at best, and are totally ignored at worst. Recently, however, not all of those are pillar clans anymore. The Gangrel have officially left, and while many individual Gangrel continue to claim membership in the sect, they no longer have any representation in the inner circle. They're a lot more common among the Anarchs than they used to be, the sect I'll be covering in my next lore video. Likewise, the Bruja have effectively left. Curiously, the Lasombra leadership have also petitioned for entry, a clan I mentioned briefly in my lore video on the Sabbat, which you can watch here, but is also going to be covered in a more in-depth video later. At the heart of the Camarilla lie the traditions, and at the heart of the traditions lies the prince. Many princes hold a regular court, which functions as a combination of social affair and legal proceeding. At court, vampires gossip and attempt to gain favor. The currency of the Camarilla is a system of favors and debts. Such debts are not only given and incurred, but are also traded between vampires in a healthy, invisible economy, so the Camarilla are always careful about whom they owe favors to. On the other hand are the Nosferatu. They trade in the other currency the Camarilla holds dear, information. If someone has a secret, the Nosferatu probably know. If you need to get into a locked building, the Nosferatu probably know how to. It's wise to stay on their good side, or the fact that you are looking for information to begin with may itself become information to be traded for the right price. According to the 20th edition of Vampire the Masquerade, the Sabbat view the Camarilla like this. The world has spun ever closer to Gehenna, and these so-called kindred are woefully unprepared for the final nights. They will be torn apart, the whole time bleeding their delusions of superiority. The Anarchs say, "I don't hate them because they're in charge. I hate them because they're a bunch of psychotic, power-hungry assholes surrounded by mindless sycophants that hope that political power comes from the end of a dick." And those vampires who call themselves independent say they rule over all kindred? The Romans had something similar going, and things will end up the same for the Camarilla. I only deal with them because they're the largest pool of clients. Now I want to hear your thoughts about the Camarilla. Are they a sect you can see yourself allying with in Bloodlines 2? Do you agree with their goals and traditions? What sect would you call the best hope for the future of vampires? I make videos multiple times a week, and every Monday is Masquerade Monday, so if you enjoy what I do, please consider hitting that subscribe button. A huge shout out to Ian Watson, aka Fawn Aether, for his help with compiling the info for this video, and for offering insight into Vampire the Masquerade lore. Thank you so very much for watching, it means the absolute world to me, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye bye!